There are places I remember all my life, though some have changed, some forever, not for better. Some have gone and some remain. All these places have their moments with lovers and friends. I still can recall.
Brooklyn has changed a lot since you arrived on June 9, 1925. Your parents, Dorothy and Joseph, brought you home to this apartment building in the heart of Flatbush. Later, you moved to Crown Heights and this fourth-floor walk-up at 332 Rogers. Today, you might not recognize the old neighborhood, but its memories are still strong.
It was a place where your mother could look out the window and say, "David, where are you?" That was the kind of neighborhood it was. I mean, I knew most of the people who had the stores in the building. There were a number of individual pop and mom shops, like a candy store. There was a paint store. Rogers Avenue, I have some fond memories because I had lots of friends. And we'd play in the hallway. We'd play cops and robbers in the hallway. And we'd make a lot of noise, and people would get very upset by the kids running around in the hallways. I had Irish friends and an Italian family, and I pretty mixed neighborhood, pretty diverse, I'd say, today.
One of your lifelong passions got its start here. Who knew your childhood friend, Leo Craig, would have such a lasting impression?
He would have, on Christmas, he would open his pop would invite me in to see his electric trains. He had a set of electric trains that ran around the tree.
Today, model trains feed your mind and soul. In the last 80 years, you've witnessed a world of change. Thankfully, your love of trains is not one of them. Here you are trying to pass on the genetic train code to one of your grandsons in 1992. 12 years later, you're helping that same grandson master another code. Other things are also unchanged, like Camp Rising Sun in upstate New York, which you attended in the 30s. It has a website now, but they're still giving promising kids from New York City, like you, a chance to grow and mature. You probably wouldn't recognize your uncle's old summer place in Hunter, New York. You spent many a summer day there, romping in the fields with Hortense and the livestock. When the 1939 World's Fair came to New York, you saw its sights and captured the autograph of your classmates at PS 161 in this album. Herbert Kahn's has a nice mathematical ring. To Davy, let your life be like arithmetic. Joys added, sorrows subtracted, friends multiplied, love undivided. Good advice.
Labor was not recognized. Man could not strike. Blacks were separated. We had segregation. There was a lot of anti-Semitism in the country. I found a lot of it in the army that I didn't expect. Women had no role to speak of. We hadn't had an atomic bomb. We didn't have computers. We didn't have television. We didn't have color rubies. So here we are. Look at all of this in one lifetime. So I think that the time that I've spent on this earth, I've seen significant changes.
You've always seemed to live a life of intellectual rigor. You have a huge library. You've published over a dozen papers in your specific field. And yet, I can't imagine you were surrounded by books as a kid.
None.
It's not my impression your parents were academic or intellectual in that respect.
Not at all.
How do you understand where you started and where you are now?
I don't know. I really have no idea, no insight whatsoever. I happen to think that, you know, teaching is one of the major efforts that we should be all doing at one time in our lives. I think the one thing you find out is in teaching you learn as much as you try to teach other people.
Of the many schools you attended, including this unique program for GIs during the occupation, where, incidentally, you took a turn on stage in a production of Ayn Rand's Night of January 16th. Of these many schools, your sentimental favorite was your high school, Brooklyn Tech. A haven for the best and brightest minds in math and science, today, at its reunions, the alumni is like a who's who of Nobel laureates.
Grandpa, as we were searching through our inventory of items, we found something that was very useful in this segment. Well, it's your gray card. Oh, let's look at it. Oh no, there's an error. It's a C. And look where it is. Principles of Chemical Engineering. Wait. Grandpa, isn't that what you went on to do when you were older? I guess those teachers don't know anything.
In spite of this small misstep, your educational career was a big success. Unfortunately, like many men your age in the 1940s, your education was interrupted. An inscription from your yearbook offers the explanation. It is the next great chapter of your life.
With summaries of the latest world news presented over these stations by Gold and Eagle Gasoline. Go ahead, New York.
The Japanese have attacked Pearl Harbor, Hawaii by air, President Roosevelt has just announced. The attack also has made on all naval and military activities in the principal island of Oahu.
I recall December 7th very vividly. I was working in a drugstore. I was a delivery boy. We were standing behind the counter, and the news, someone said, "Did you know they bombed Pearl Harbor?" Everybody collected at the radio, and they turned up the radio, and everyone that came in said, "What are we going to do?"
The next day, your country went to war. But being 16, you returned to school. When you did come of age, you would never be called to service because you were an only child, which the law protected. But that had no appeal to you.
I registered in my birthday in June 1943. I asked them I'd like to be taken as soon as possible.
Why?
Well, all my friends are going.
You applied to the service academies, West Point and Annapolis, but colorblindness made you ineligible. No problem, the Army was taking everybody.
I'm not sure if it was September 13th or somewhere around there that I got my notice to report to Camp Upton, which was in New York on Long Island. I remember getting on the Long Island train.
This is the G.I. Jive, man alive. It starts with the bugler blowing reveille over your bed when you arrive. Jack, that's the G.I. Jive.
Later, you moved here to Fort Benning for basic training. Your above average score on the Army's classification test gained you admission into ASTP, the Army Specialist Training Program. It was the Army's answer for the geniuses in its ranks.
You would have some preliminary training at college in engineering or medicine or something else, or languages, and you would become, you know, get an officer's commission.
Dubbed All Safe Till Peace by critics, the ASTP soldiers were sent directly to college. You found yourself at the University of Illinois.
That was basically, that was great, you know. And I think for the most part, everyone said, well, gee whiz, I'm going to be in the Army, I don't have to be in the infantry.
Unfortunately, the infantry is exactly where you ended up. By mid-1944, the meat grinder of combat in Europe needed bodies. In Citizen Soldier, historian Stephen Ambrose captures why your cushy ASTP program was suddenly canceled. At a time when every other combatant was taking conscripts too old, too young, too ill to be fighters, the U.S. Army was feeding into its fighting force its best and brightest young men.
It was a singularly the most important experience of my lifetime, next to being married, I think. I mean, it was a total break with the past, a total break with your family. You were put in a totally new environment for which you had never experienced anything like it before, and the Army is that way.
Being in a combat engineer unit meant hard work. You helped build roads, bridges, remove mines, and you bumped forward towards Germany in this half-track, the Booze Hound. You ate and slept where and when you could, and hot showers were not part of the experience. The inscription on the back of this photo says, "No bath in a month."
Did they teach you lessons or tools for life?
I don't think they taught us tools for life. They taught you how to survive. I mean, the Army is, let's be honest, the Army is to make killers out of you. And it's to make good ones out of you. And to be people who are aware, you know, that you will survive. You will do what is necessary in order to survive.
You shared the hardships and the laughs with your buddies. From snafu to FUBAR to Kilroy was here, you were in it together. You and Jim Ronkel got a four-day pass to Paris and the Red Cross Club, where you took this snapshot.
There's a different feeling about the relationship you had that you take away with you. Relationship among your peers. Relationships that you develop that are very strong relationships that you really never forget.
That there are feelings about it that I don't know really the depth of, you know, what, you know, you do really, you have strong memories about people, really. You know, you remember the fact that the guy that you were friendly with died. Eli Fine, he was a nice guy. Jim Runkle. And we went to Paris together on the pass, and it was a lot of fun.